Going. And we're going live. And we're live. We're up. We got the right camera on. Yeah, we are. Hey, Linda, how are you?
Great.
Good. Talk louder, please. Thank you. Okay. Hey, everybody on Spotify, SoundCloud, iTunes, iHeartRadio, Google, and some other ones that I'm possibly missing. Thank you so much for tuning in. Everybody on YouTube Live, it's great to see you. If you're watching the replay, sorry you missed the questions, but everything is relevant that we're going to talk about tonight. Make sure on my YouTube channel that you join the YouTube channel. You join it and then turn on your notification. So you subscribe and then turn on your notification so you get notified every time I upload a new video, which is actually almost daily. I'm doing two of these Q&As a week, and I'm negotiating to do a third one. But we're underneath deep negotiations with some outside talent, so we'll see how it works.
There's not going to be any promotions internally?
Yeah, but the person coming from outside the house to...
I'm talking about me. Maybe I need a promotion.
So what kind of promotion do you want?
I don't know. It's
do you mean promoting your business?
No, it's negotiable. No.
Oh, you're willing to do a third show? Oh, I thought you weren't. You're my first choice. I lost my first choice, so I went to my second choice. Okay, Linda, you want to do a third show?
It's worth talking about.
Okay,
if you have anything to offer me, then you know, maybe.
All right. So, well, I promise you to keep not having sex with you. That's got to be worth something. Right? Okay, guys, believe it or not, this is a dog training show. My name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training, and I've got a dog training facility. Trust me, it's not a relationship facility. It's a dog training facility up in Providence, Rhode Island. We specialize in aggression rehab, behavior modification. We're really, really good at stopping unwanted behaviors. The number one reason why dogs are killed in this world is because somebody couldn't stop an unwanted behavior. That is the bottom line. That is why people turn in their dogs into shelters and they rehome them or they abandon them on the streets, is because they couldn't stop something. Obviously, we also train dogs what to do. We obviously train dogs on all their basic obedience, on leash and off leash, and high levels of distractions. We're really good at working on with highly nervous, anxious, fearful dogs. I travel the world. I do dog training seminars. You can go to rvdogtrainer.com, rvdogtrainer.com, and you can see my schedule. Also, you can jump onto my Patreon page, patreon.com/solidcaninetraining. You can get a lot of one-on-one help there. You can also do Skypes with me. The information that we have tonight, it's going to be short, it's going to be sweet, it will not be complete. The reason is most people need at least an hour response. I'm trying to just help people break through some of the barriers that people have got, give people the confidence. I'm also going to be talking a lot about punishment tonight. Punishment is not abuse. It is a fact of life. All animals are punished and rewarded. So if we want more of something, we reward. If we want less of something, we punish. Most of the questions that I get tonight are going to be, how do I stop a certain behavior? The only way to stop a certain behavior is punishment. I'm fully aware of the conversation out there. All this stuff where people are quoting science is a bunch of bullshit. All right? They don't know what they're talking about. It's all feel-good snowflake stuff. Trust me, on an average day, you'll probably hear us say yes with a food reward or a clicker over 1,000 times. And you'll probably only hear us say no less than 24 times. And that's how we're rehabbing dogs. So, but tonight, what you're going to do is you're going to hear me say punishment a lot because people want to know how to stop a behavior. So let's go right into it. And here we go. There's also something called Super Chats. There's a little dollar sign there, dollar bill, y'all. And if you click the dollar sign, you can throw us some cash. Linda and I use that for date night. Mm-hmm. Tonight, this week, we went to Luxburger. We Instagram story our date night. Thank you for all the people that supported us last week. You paid for a very fantastic dinner. We did have to negotiate dessert. I think I came on above. Linda was not thrilled with it. It was tiramisu.
No, it was not. It was creme brulee.
Oh, shit. You're right. It was creme brulee. creme brew freaking brulee. Oh, okay. So, all right, there you go. So here we go. First question. Next.
Julie's Canine Academy. Hi, Jeff and Linda. Hello.
Hey, Julie. How are you? Julie and Josh and Heather. Hello. How are you? Next.
Abington.
Hey, Abington.
Working with an 11-month-old GSD client with high drive, dog is aggressive with certain strangers, already bit three people. Recommendations where to start for me as a trainer?
Okay, so Abington 586, massive amounts of respect for you and what you're about to take on. But I must say, and I'm not being disrespectful, if you follow me long enough, you'll know that. You should already know the answer to that. All right, you should already know the answer. Please don't work with aggressive dogs, especially human aggressive dogs, unless you have experience. That's why you're asking me the question, how are you supposed to get experience without working with the dogs? I just want you to be careful. I've been mauled before, not bitten, mauled. It's not fun. And two of the times was because I was working with dogs above my pay grade. One of the times was just a fluke. And I used to get bit a lot in my young career because I was working with dogs off my pay grade. So, but mad respect for you, but I just want you, I say this because it could save your life, it could save your career, it could save the life of the dog. The first thing you want to do is stay safe. This dog needs to be muzzle conditioned. If you can't do it, the owner should be able to do it. You have to understand aggression. You have to understand how to stop aggression. You have to understand how to put dogs into avoidance and then acceptance. And then you've got to be able to work on multiple different things. So the biggest thing is to stay safe. An 11-month-old German Shepherd that's high drive is not even into full maturity yet. So you have not even seen the worst of it yet. So a lot of it is education of the owners. So this is actually a 3-hour Skype session, private one-on-one with you and I, because that's what it's going to take. If you want to be taking on these clients, what I suggest you do is you find somebody that specializes in aggression and you do an internship with them. You do a shadow program with them. You volunteer your time with them and you learn as much stuff as you possibly can. What you need to do is first is stay safe. Make sure that dog is muzzle conditioned. You need to know how to remote collar work. Those are going to be your biggest thing. Massive amounts of structure is going to be required. Huge amounts of education for the human client. They need to understand this is life or death. So you need to understand people really, really well. You need to figure out what they're doing that's possibly encouraging it and respectfully tell them how to do it. The art of dog training, of being a successful dog trainer, is the communication with humans. The dogs are the easy parts, but they're difficult. The human is the difficult part, but that's how we get paid, and that's who's going to be owning these dogs. So the art of communication with humans is very, very important. You have to, so you want to start with safety number one, and then everything is structure. I would encourage you, though, I can't give you tips. I don't give tips on aggression because it is a complete, overhaul of the dog. I would encourage you to join my Patreon channel. I'm not trying to get $5 a month from you, but if you want to take on these dogs, you're gonna need some help, but safety is number one. Next.
Leanne says hello.
Hey, Leanne, how are you?
Russ says, hey, Jeff and
hey,
Linda.
Hey, Russ. Man, Russ, I'm loving your social media, buddy.
Heather says, hi, guys. Love your shirt, Linda.
Awesome.
Why, thank you.
Awesome. Gary V's in the house.
Gary V.
Yep.
Lydia, dog is a bit of a cheeky jerk while trying to get any collar on, throwing self on ground, mouthy, avoiding collar. Bonker did not snap him out of it. He gets more playful. What's next?
So if Lydia, chances are you didn't use the bonker firm enough. So a bonker is this. It is a towel. What I need you to do is you should be saying the word no, and you should be throwing this at the dog extremely, extremely firmly. Okay? Extremely firmly. Now what I want you to do is I want you to watch a video of mine. It's on my YouTube channel. It's called Rupert, R-U-P-E-R-T, Collar Conditioning. It's a clicker food protocol. Okay? And your dog is going to love putting on a leash and collar. It's going to love, because that's the only way it's going to eat for 3 weeks. So that's what it's going to do. It's going to love it. It's going to stick its head out. It's going to wait patiently. You're going to be able to put a collar on your dog, put a leash on your dog, and it will still wait for you until you release it. That's how you're going to do it. But first step is stop the bad behavior. In all behavior modification, guys, in all behavior modification, you need to stop the unwanted behavior first, okay? I cannot rehab you off of drugs and alcohol until you've actually stopped using. Then the work begins. Okay, it's the same with any bad behavior. So I would encourage you to use a bonker much firmer. The dog thinks it's a game. You didn't do it right, most likely. So no, hard. You can't, your dogs are not glass. My dogs have run into walls before chasing a ball. They've run into trees before. They've run into signposts. It didn't feel good, but guess what? They kept going. So you bonk the dog. Next.
Russ says, you guys are great.
Thanks, Russ.
Thanks, Russ. Kayla says, love you, Jeff.
Oh, my gosh. Thank you, Kayla.
Josh, six-month-old GSD is jumping out of fence again. I've corrected at 100 with e-collar. She stopped but is back at it again. So dangerous and frustrating. Jeff and Linda, thank you and love you both.
All right. So, Josh, this is what I would do. All right. So I'm not there. I don't know what's happening. You can't give your dog freedom. I would put up hot wire. I would go to Tractor Supply, run some hot wire. It's cattle wire. Run it around your the perimeter of your fence. Keep your dog on a long line. You might have to catch your dog in the act on a long line and yank really hard on that long line. You can't leave your dog unsupervised. You can also put up something called coyote rollers. Every once in a while, you get a dog that just won't stop jumping over fences. If you got a 6-month-old German Shepherd dog, you know. Also, I would say, what else is going on in your dog's life? How much structure is in your dog's life? Why is your dog being accountable to you in every aspect of its life? Does it go in its crate? Does it come out of its crates when you want? Does it do a downstay? Can it heal next to you properly? Can you recall it in your backyard when it's in a full sprint? So what I need you to do is to be able to learn how to start controlling that dog's drive. We don't get rid of dogs' drives. We control them. I want a high drive dog. So for some reason, your dog wants to jump fences. So, you know, a lot of people would say, well, is your dog neutered yet? And it's like, well, neuter it. It'll stop jumping fences. No, it won't. Okay? I assure you, that dog's balls are not weighing it down that much. Okay? Don't worry. If anything, it'll jump fences more. Actually, that would be reverse because the balls will weigh it down and keep it in the fence. So them balls ain't, that didn't make sense. But anyway, it's not gonna do it. All right? Hot wire, but also 6 months old, 100. Maybe it's not on tight enough. Also, if your dog is really drivey, dogs blow through 100. You might need a more powerful collar. You might need a double collar. Bottom line is, when you want to stop a dog from jumping a fence, you need to make it suck to jump the fence. And if anybody thinks that's mean, you've never seen a dog splattered on the side of the road with its head popped open and its brains coming out because it got hit by a car because it got out of a fence. Graphic, I know, but I'm sorry. I will give a dog a 1 to 3 second correction any day of the week instead of seeing that. Next.
Spinisper.
Yes. We got a super chat. Did it not show up on your screen?
I don't see it.
All right.
Our new puppy comes on Friday, and I have been studying your videos like crazy each day. I feel more and more confident. Thanks, Jeff. Also excited about coming to seminar in 2 weeks.
Oh, awesome. You're going to be in Providence. I can't wait to see you.
Is that in 2 weeks?
Yeah, it's in 2 weeks. Two weekends from this weekend, yes. So I think it was Sabrina that, Sabrina, $1.99. Thank you so much. Love you.
I didn't get it.
Next.
Boston Mommy.
Hey, Boston Mommy.
My dog goes after coworker's dog in yard when running. He bites their butt. Then when they turn on him and he runs and bites neck, won't stop friends when not running dogs.
Okay. So again, so your dog can't be off leash. So this is the thing, guys. We can't just assume our dogs are going to make the right decision. So if I had a dog who was behaving like that and I didn't have the ability to train it, what I would be able to do is, number one, is never let it off leash right now until I fixed it. So what you need to do is you need to teach your dog proper dog play. The way you do that is you have to do that in a socialization structure like we have at our training center. I would remote collar train that dog. The reason why I use a remote collar is because you can control your dog up to a mile away. So you can have a conversation. I remote collar train that dog. Don't use the remote collar for the first time for this situation, but train your dog how to recall, how to do a down, how to heal next to you. Teach your dog how to, if it sniffs by the trash can, correct it for sniffing by the trash can. If it gets up on the counters, correct it for getting it up on the counters so it understands what a punisher with a remote collar is. Then, if it's getting all obnoxious around the other dog, you can use the collar as well. Most people, what they do is they're being reactive instead of proactive. I know exactly what this looks like. I can already envision it in your house, probably what's happening. The cool thing about using electronics is you never have to raise your voice. The cool thing about fully off-leash training your dog to a pretty good quality is you never have to yell. Remote collars are fantastic. They can yell for you. You get to stay calm. So what we would do is we'd have that dog on a long line, on a leash, and be able to make sure we can control that dog and then use a remote collar as well so it understands, because remote collars are not directional. That's what we would do. What your dog is doing is it's doing rough play, but it's not fair to the other dog. So I allow my dogs to play like that with each other, but I also can tell them to knock it off. You need to be able to teach your dog to knock it off. A remote collar is going to help you do that, but there's also a training component as well. Next.
AJ.
Hey, AJ.
Saw some recent training videos posted on YouTube. The prong collars are at mid-neck on some dogs. Is this because they're already compliant? Asking because my dog is less compliant when it's low, less snug.
It could be because they've had them on for a little bit and they just go down. No, a compliant dog doesn't get to wear it lower. It could just be they're in between links. The links go down a little bit. I've seen photos of our dogs where the collars are riding a little bit low. It's like, you know, definitely at the beginning, we want to make sure they're up high. It's not because we don't go, hey, let's put them down lower because the dogs are listening. Sometimes that when you're working the dog for a little bit of time, they happen to go down. And if you happen to snap a picture at that time, then that's what you're going to get. Ideally, the collar should go up high though. Next.
Chevy.
Hey, Chevy.
Hey guys, my friend's got a puppy and want me to train it and them. I need experience, but is it a good idea to work with friends?
No, it's not, but for the experience, go ahead. You don't work with friends, you don't work with family. But for the experience, go ahead. Next.
Anthony?
Yep.
I have a Catahoula mix that has high fear aggression at the vet. Any suggestions to rehabilitate? Have you heard of fear-free vets?
Yeah, I've heard of fear-free vets. It's a great marketing ploy. Okay? Your dog is still going to be afraid. It's not the vet that's the problem. It's the dog that's the problem. I have dogs that hate the vet. Guess what? Fear-free vet is a marketing ploy to work on your heartstrings. Like, that vet's nicer than your vet? No, it's not. Like, some dogs just don't like the vets. So what you do is you role play vet stuff at your house. But to me, I go to the vet once every couple of years for my dog. Dogs, every one of my dogs gets muzzled up for the vet. Every one of them. I go in with my dog. I handle my dog. The vet does what they want. If my dog growls a little bit, I tell my dog to knock it off. You know, what? You shove a finger up a dog's ass. You put a finger up my ass and I'm not ready, I'm going to growl. If I'm ready, I'm going to tip you 20. So with your dog, sorry. Sorry. So you think $20 is too little? 50? You think I should tip $50?
I don't think you should.
Oh, you're crazy.
Well, yeah, clearly.
$50. No, thank you. No. So what I would do is I would role play this at your house. What we do is we put the dogs up on surfaces. We do a lot of clicker and food work. We lift the dog's ears, touch the dog's mouth. We touch all their body. We touch their paws. We lift their tail. We actually get a stethoscope and we put it around the dog. We actually role play vet stuff with our client dogs. You can do that. Next.
This one's from Rachel. Yes. Hey, Jeff and Linda. Any thoughts on yearly vaccinating, spay, neuter, and flea and heartworm prevention?
Rachel, I'm a dog trainer. So I also feed raw, but I don't give advice out on raw. So all I know is this: by law, we have to do certain vaccinations, but we don't vaccinate our kids against something. Like, we don't do flu shots ourselves. We don't give our kids the flu shot. You know, we're against the HPV virus for females. Linda's probably even more hardcore than I am on a lot of stuff. You know, rabies shot, theoretically, a dog needs it once in its life, but I get it. You know, you can always do titers, flea and tick. I don't want my dog. There's a lot of natural remedies for that at all, but I'm far from qualified to even talk about that stuff. I'm a dog trainer. Next.
Robin G.
Hey, Robin.
Walked a reactive, anxious dog the other day, did a 180 turn with strong leash pop, and he bit.
Yep.
It scared him, but now he looks for guidance. Place command next. On the right track?
Sounds good to me. Sounds good to me. Place command is one of the first things we teach, by the way. Yeah. So, you know, thresholds, in and out of the crate, place, structured walk. Teach your dog how to relax. Next.
Abington says, thanks so much. Appreciate it.
No problem, Abington.
Next one is Ray. Hi, can I ask about pack structure? My Labrador bit my Doberman. We have five dogs, but 95% of the time they're okay. What exercises can I do for them to be confident in their rank and eliminate fighting?
So that's the thing. That's the, you know, that's the thing, Ray, is I get hired for 5 to 10%. You know what I mean? That's how I make a living. 90% of what your dog does is probably pretty decent. People pay me the big bucks for the 10%. As far as what you can do about the rank, I mean, this is the thing. It's about, you know, we'd have to know exactly what was the trigger for the dog biting. And I don't need to know necessarily why dogs bite. I know how to stop the biting, but I can stop the biting in the act, and I can stop the precursor to the biting. So you want to know, you have to be able to recognize when your dog's going to bite. There's always a sign. It's usually over a resource. So was there food, toy, human, space? Was it a noise? Was it noise activated? Was the dogs in drive? Were the dogs not in drive? Were they all trying to crowd towards a certain area? Were they outside running? A lot of different variables. As far as pack structure, you know, I'm the freaking pack leader. I run the show. Bottom line, everybody's below me. And that doesn't mean I'm yelling at my dogs. I'm not bossing my dogs around. I'm a leader, not a boss. It's a huge difference. So what can you do is more structure in your house. You have five dogs. You should have massive structure in your house. Next.
This one's from Jason. If I want to teach my dog a competition heel, should I give a different command from our regular heeled walks?
I would imagine so, and I would talk to a sport dog trainer or just get videos. There's tons of videos on YouTube. We don't teach competition heels, and it's a whole other thing. You easily can just give it a different command. If you say heel now, you can pick German or French or Belgian or Czech to give it the focused heel if you want to. Next.
This one's from Jorge. Sorry for hijacking the chat, but just started with the prong collar with my mixed race, medium-sized, strong-willed 3-year-old dog today.
Awesome.
I noticed that the dog will chew the leash or softly bite my hand, jump on me, or fight me to go the other way instead of getting close to me unless I call him. When I can walk him with the...
You can't ask these long questions because we're going to get lost.
I can't keep up with them. I'm totally lost.
Yep.
I don't know.
Okay, so this is the thing. So Jorge, you're not hijacking the leash, the thing, but you can't ask the YouTube comment section is not conducive to long comments. That's a Patreon question. This is the thing. Make sure you do the prong collar dance. Just to clarify, though, the prong collar is not making the dog become aggressive or making the dog bite the leash. Your dog is saying no to you. I want to make sure your dog is walking properly next to you. It should be next to you in a proper heel. Your dog only needs that much leash. We don't do the formal like AKC competition obedience with a leash and a big J. That dog only gets that much leash. Keep the leash next to you. The leash should be it should be loose, not taut. If the leash is taut, it's activated. You should be giving the dog a slight pop prior to the dog forging ahead. Make sure you watch my prong collar conditioning video though that explains to you how to introduce the collar to the dog. What you don't want to do is just put the collar on the dog and then go for a walk. You want to do all of this stuff interior, literally inside your house, in your basement, maybe in your backyard, with little distractions as possible. You need to educate the dog. What the dog does is, it's very common, the dog will bite the leash because it gets frustrated that it can't get ahead. So that's what's happening. It always happens. We have dogs that do crocodile rolls as well. Next.
This one is from Marianne. We did this... That was the one we already.
Yes, Sabrina. Okay, yes, Sabrina. Thank you. Love you, honey. Next.
From Marianne, I'm about to sign up for a 1-hour T3 Skype session. I'm so excited. Can't wait.
Oh, awesome. Cool.
Leanne.
I'll look out for that. Yep. Hey, Leanne.
Any suggestions for where to start with scent work? Wanting a new activity to do with my off-leash trained hound.
Right. I don't do scent work at all. What I would do is there's tons of free videos out there on YouTube. There's plenty of people out there that are way more experienced. Like just about any, put it this way, anybody that does scent work is way more experienced than I am. But you can use essential oils if you want to. You can use like kit boxes from the post office. You can use wooden boxes. You can use, you know, any sort of packing box. You can use shoe boxes. And scent work is a lot of fun for your dog and you. Next.
Tiffany.
Yep.
Silly question, but if you have a remote on a dog that is mounting another dog, will the dog on the bottom receive a stim?
Tiffany, if there's full penetration, the dog, I won't even go there. Okay. No, it won't. It's a muscle stimulator. It's not electricity. So it's not like if I stood in a puddle of water and I got shocked and Linda touched me, she got shocked. It's not like that. It's not like that.
Did that happen?
Yeah.
I had no idea.
Sure. Yeah, but you, if I'm ever getting electrocuted, don't jump in the bathtub with me to save me.
Well,
you'll die too. Unplug the fucking hair dryer or the toaster that you threw in.
Flat iron.
Okay.
Actually, yes. I would never do that to my flat iron. Sabrina.
Yeah.
Just want to say that it goes against the grain to correct fear with e-collar. It really works.
Of course it works.
He now doesn't even pay attention to the handheld vacuum.
Guys,
thank you.
Guess how we rehabilitate fear? With punishment. And you have all these freaking and we're doing it. We're in the trenches doing it. We have the before. This is not ego-based stuff, guys. You know, the reason why is if you're brand new to my world and it's like, God, this guy is cocky. It's like, no, dogs are dying. Dogs are dying. People are going to freaking trainers that are taking 18 weeks to get a dog to walk on a leash. People can't stop jumping. There's dog trainers that can't stop their own dogs from jumping on them. It takes 2 seconds to stop a dog from jumping. No, there's a huge amount of unethics out there, and there's a huge amount of lying and misinformation. So we like every dog that comes into our property is fearful. When you see a dog and we take a photo of it and it looks afraid, it could be a couple of things. Number one, it's getting a camera stuck in its face. Number two, that's how the dog came to us. So we specialize in fearful dogs. So somebody that specializes in fearful dogs, you're going to see a lot of fearful photos. If you run a camp for overweight people, guess what you're going to see a lot of photos of? Overweight people. It's just the way it works, right? When you go to Betty Ford, you're going to see a lot of drug addicts and alcoholics. Betty Ford didn't create them. All right? Skinny people aren't signing up for Weight Watchers. So, I mean, it's like, that's why when a lot of times people are like, oh my God, the dog looks so afraid. It's like, I know, that's why it's with us. So we use punishment to actually correct fear, and it works big. Because you only have two ways to do things, reward and punishment. Now, do we build the dogs up? Absolutely. Do we do confidence building drills? A ton. But what we do is we can correct fearful reactions to things. And then what happens is, just like cognitive behavioral therapy, go get CBT for dummies, cognitive behavioral therapy for dummies, get that book. You'll start understanding the rehab process of humans, and you can actually apply that to dogs. Next.
P.S. You're not dummies.
Next.
It's just the book.
No, it's just the book.
Co-Gab 16.
Yes.
ACD, pulling her leash bad, hard to correct.
So use a remote collar or prong collar. If you've got your dog on a harness, you're training your dog to pull. On a martingale, same thing. On a flat buckle collar, same thing. On a choke chain or slip lead, same thing. If you're using a head halter, you're using it wrong. So a prong collar or a remote collar, watch my videos, teach your dog how to walk politely on a leash. That's usually a less than 5-minute training protocol. Next.
Blue one black.
Yes.
My dog is so laid back with other dogs, he'll tolerate all sorts of behavior except when they want to sniff him underneath, not the butt.
Mm.
Oh, he changes attitude immediately. Any suggestions help?
Yeah, I mean, so this is the thing. You know, I'm not a big fan of strangers sniffing my dick. So, you know, the big thing is this, is a lot of dogs just don't like it. Now, could you rehab it? Of course you could. This is what we do. We have a dog on a slip lead and we walk him around our socialization yard, and we first walk him around the socialization yard and we keep all the dogs away. All right. We keep all the dogs away. We do that a couple of times. And then what we do is we call a dog over. We call a dog over. And then we make sure the dog's head that doesn't like to be sniffed is with us. We control the dog's head. Then we allow the other dog to get in a quick sniff, a 1 second sniff. And then we pull the dog away and we push the other sniffer away. Sniffy comes with me. Sniffer moves away. And then we reward the dog for putting up with it. And then we do it over and over and over and over again. And then still, but you still got to advocate for your dog. If there was a dog sniffing my dog and like, and if my dog definitely didn't like it, I'm not going to be like, hey, dog of mine, learn to deal with it. I'm going to be like, hey, pain in the ass sniffer, get the hell out of here. Okay, next.
Jute 1974, how can I get Jack to use his rear paws when he swims? Any tips?
Ooh, I don't think the front door is open. I don't know if that was Joelle with her mom.
What?
Joelle, I don't know. I just heard the gate open. I don't know if the front door is open for Joelle to get in. She might not know how to do it. All right. Thanks. Sorry. All right. Use a leash. So watch my videos on how to teach a dog to swim. I've got YouTube videos on how to teach a dog to swim. There's three of them, in-ground pool, above-ground pool, and then a stream, lake, ocean. And then what I want you to do is I want you to use the leash and slightly pull your dog. And that should flatten your dog out. Megan, thank you for the live and the free content. You're welcome. I hope to attend one of your seminars and T3 eventually. I hope you and Lynn have a wonderful night. We will. It'd be great to see you at T3. T3, you can go to t3seminar.com. It's a 7-day seminar. We do three of them a year with my buddy Sean O'Shea and Tori Smith. And then RV dog training seminar. That's because I travel the world, well, all of North America in my RV. I fly across, fly into other countries, obviously. And then what you want to do is you can go to rvdogtrainer.com and you can see the schedule there. All right. Hey, Michael. Michael, how are you? 6 months ago, my cat died from an unknown injury. Oh, I'm sorry, Mike. Sucks when a pet dies. It's a good chance that came from my dog trying to play. Ooh, not good. I just ended up with a new kitten. Should I just go for full avoidance or correct any arousal? Let's go for full avoidance right now. Let's go for full avoidance. Let's just do that. It won't hurt to do that. All right. And I'm sorry about your loss, Michael. S. Jotes, LOL. And then next question. Hey, Joelle.
Oh, is that Steph? S. J. Oates. That's Steph.
Oh, hey, Steph.
LOL from her.
Yep.
How's it going? All right. Cecily. Hey, you two, looking good as always. Oh, thanks. Jeff, could you give a quick explanation of how to teach a super fearful dog to down using a remote collar outside of the home? But not in the water. Any suggestions?
Yeah, you don't want to do it down in the water. Okay, so this is what I want you to do. First, you need to teach it inside the home. I want you to do this. First, can your dog do down with leash pressure? So what you do is this. Leash pressure, food lure. We don't do free shaping. So we don't do free shaping at all. I'm not against free shaping at all. My dogs are trick trained, and I guess how my dogs learn through free shaping. So I'm not against it. I'm a big fan of agility. I'm a huge fan of trick training. So what I want you to do is this. Let me make sure. Just who texted me now. Was that you? Oh, there you go. Okay. Was the front door locked?
Yeah, I opened it. I almost peed my pants.
Right. Well,
you can go. I knew she was going
to
be there.
We have to give you instructions on how to get around. Okay? We have to, because I don't have a key to that door.
But how can I know? I knew she was there, and yet still I opened the door and went, I see.
I'm sure that's great for your ego, right?
Yeah.
That's great. All right. So what I want you to do is this. So leash pressure down into a down. Then what I want you to do is I want you to layer leash pressure with remote pressure. So pressure on the remote, working level. Remote pressure on, leash pressure on. Remote pressure on, leash pressure on. And then you start lightening up on the leash pressure. You keep the remote pressure the same. And then eventually you do it with just the verbal and the remote. Next. Mm-hmm. Maria,
you kill me, Jeff. Worth watching just for the Jeffisms.
Write them down, man. We're making a line of T-shirts. Thanks.
Okay, Cecily has another part to her question, yep. I think. I will find the working level and begin in the home, but I am anticipating a rise in stim once dog is outside and having a panic attack.
Exactly. But don't use down to overcome a panic attack. Your dog's not going to freaking down. That's not how you do it. So You want your dog to be able to down. If your dog's in a down and then all of a sudden becomes afraid, yes, you can put your dog back into a down. All right, next.
I messed up. She had a couple questions in between. There was one about swimming, and that's why it said okay. Not in the water.
Okay, but we have to keep the flow going.
Let me read it. My pup looks like she is struggling while swimming, almost as if she isn't using her back legs. She does touch pad work for focused healing, so she knows she has an ass.
Okay, but she also knows she has an ass probably because everyone's been making fun of it, and especially if she's in eighth or ninth grade. So this is the thing. It's got nothing to do with it. Touch pad work and swimming are not connected. Got it? They're not connected at all. All right? So what I want you to do is watch my video on YouTube, leash pressure. You need to get the dog moving. So dogs that don't use their back legs swim with their head up a little bit much, like Tex is doing now. If you watch Tex swim, I want you to go like this more and go like that. There you go. And then the back legs kick out. They'll very rarely will they just drag them. Next.
Heather, what's the appropriate way to introduce an e-collar to a dog?
What you can do is you put it on, you find the working level. You make sure fit is the most important thing. Find the working level, and you can start with a place command. And I've got videos on that on my YouTube channel. Next.
Ray says, thank you so much, Jeff.
You're welcome, Ray.
Jody.
Hey, Jody.
Hi from Oz.
What?
Where's Oz?
Australia.
Oh, okay. Pair of mini dachshunds who are extremely fearful, can barely get near them, leading into aggression, have made small progress in building bond, have corrected aggression I've seen. Is there something I can do to speed up the process?
Yeah, I mean, separate them. So if you've got a couple of them, I would start separating them and working them separate. Kennel one up, work one separate. Or if you're doing a board and train, do one pair at a time. Speed it up. I mean, yeah. If you use more compulsion, everything speeds up. But what I want, but it's going to it takes a little bit of time. It takes a little bit of time. So the best thing you can do is remote collar train them. So then you can hold them accountable for everything. So more pressure is going to help you. Also, make sure if this is an at-home client, it's going to be really, really hard because you're only seeing them for minimal times per week. And you need them. You need these dogs 24 hours a day. So the way you speed up the process is you have them do a board and train. And then you control 24 hours, 7 days a week of their life. And you put them into a massively structured program. And that's how you end up. That's how you speed it up. Next.
This one's from Jorge. Sorry, I tried the leash dance, but I had those results. I will follow your advice. Regards from Costa Rica, where we don't have
basements. Oh, you don't have basements. Oh, welcome. Thank you for Costa Rica. Hey, you know what? I would love to buy some land in Costa Rica, do an Airbnb there. Get a hold of me if you know of any land and a good place to buy some. This is the thing, Jorge. So forget about the basement. You're doing it in your backyard, but slow it down. But also what you can do is, I just want you to know, Jorge, that the biting of the leash is a normal response for the dog, which you can correct. So you can correct. Make yourself a bonker. So a bonker is a towel wrapped up. And if the dog's biting the leash, you can say no, boom, bop the dog. A lot of this sounds like, if you're brand new to my world and if you're brand new to my show, there's a lot of new people on here. A lot of this stuff sounds really, really harsh, but like, people have got to understand we're talking about rehabilitating a dog and stopping some unwanted behaviors. And also, don't believe the headlines out there, guys. There's a lot of people that are headline readers. This whole like positive reinforcement's the only way to train a dog. That's the biggest lie out there. Okay? It's such a lie. First of all, it's impossible. I want people to understand that. I'm very aware of the conversation out there. We use positive reinforcement to train all kinds of things every day at our training center. The only way to stop stuff is through punishment, though. Punishment is not bad. I freely, proudly use the word punishment instead of correction because that's what it factually is. There's no yelling. There's no screaming. You're not mad. You're not upset. It's just a matter of fact. You can't do that. Every time a police officer calmly gives you a ticket, you've been punished. Right? When I take away electronics from one of my kids, I say, give me your cell phone, you're losing it for a week. I'm not mad, just matter of fact. Now they are, but they're human. They're not dogs. Next.
So mad.
Yeah.
Dog starts to lie behind and heel when passing things that make him nervous. Should I let him do this or correct this behavior?
I correct the behavior, speed him up a little bit because he's thinking too much. Next. Thanks, AJ.
Tiffany.
Hey.
At what age do you recommend a board and train for a puppy for just basic obedience and manners?
basic obedience and manners is what you can do. Oh, geez, you can start that at, 12 to 14 weeks old. I mean, you start training the dog at 8 weeks old. A boarding train, to get the most out of a boarding train, it would be great if the owner started doing all the work up until 14 weeks and you grab the dog at 14 weeks, you know, that would be great. I mean, but if the dog's there for 2 weeks, at 16 weeks, it's only going to learn so much. It'll only learn foundation stuff. It's probably not going to really, it's not going to learn a lot of duration. Like, it won't be able to hold long, you know, commands historically. So, 6 months is good, but that's if someone else is doing the work. See, I don't want owners to do the work, but if you got a dog, if an owner got a dog at 6 months, boom, it's ready. 5 months, it's ready. 16 weeks, which is 4 months, it's ready. Next.
Cecily says, best way to describe a stim to a client in 60 seconds.
I don't do it. I don't. I explain stuff to you guys. If a client calls me up and says, what does the remote collar feel like? I don't describe it. We have videos for that. Like, watch our videos. You can say it's a lot of different things. The best thing to do is to hand it to them and then let them feel it. But they're humans and your dog's a dog. Does that make sense? But, you know, this is what everybody's worried about. The bottom line is this. Is my dog going to be hurt? Let's all be honest with each other, guys. The only reason why they are banning shock collars in the UK is because they think it hurts the dogs. Now, I'm going to be doing a long video about the whole UK thing. More dogs are going to die in the next 5 years than it probably ever happened in that country. It is going to be horrific. You have all these people dancing and celebrating because they think that now that dogs are going to be treated more humane. Bullshit. People are going to be using more force with dogs than ever before. Because it's a two-pronged approach. Number one, most dog trainers suck. They can't freaking get a dog to even walk on a leash. They can't get a dog to stop jumping. Fact. They just can't. So until dog trainers out there that spout no punishment actually can train a dog, well, then they really don't have a leg to stand on. I could care less how you train a dog. It doesn't matter to me. It doesn't matter. If this tool is bad, fine. Take a dog and train it and show the video. They can't. And I'm not talking about in a show ring. Guys, I'm a family pet dog trainer. Nobody gives a shit about show ring stuff except for show ring people, and that's a very small minority. Everybody's living in their own little world, but pet dogs, people have. So sport dogs, not a ton of them. Show dogs, not a ton of them. Trick training and Hollywood dogs, not a ton of them. Pet dogs, a massive amount of them. Most trainers are not capable of getting your average family pet dog to any level of obedience that is acceptable for public access. They can't do it. They're not doing it. They're just not. Owners aren't that stupid. They're not that bad. They're not lazy. They're not given the right instructions. So all these people celebrating that shock collars are being banned, you think that you're helping families and dogs, you are hurting them. It is going to come back to bite you. More dogs are going to be surrendered. More dogs are going to be killed. It's going to be incredible. But the bottom line is people, they just don't want. I'm against abuse. I'm 100% against abuse. We have laws in this country now that prevent animal abuse, though. We have animal abuse registries in every country, in every state. Guess what? Not too many people are on them. So if there's all this rampant abuse, why are not all these people on these animal abuse registries? Where are these people? When you start banning and outlawing tools, who is going to enforce these laws? And then who is going to pay for it? Who's going to go around and respond to all these phone calls of people using tools or methods that are deemed abusive? Who is going to be the one that responds to it? And then what part of your tax dollars are going to pay for that? Every time there is a law enacted, the people that set this law need to put aside a budget to enforce the law. Like, this is government 101. This is how people are supposed to be thinking when they enact laws. Everyone's really good at saying, let's cut this, let's cut that. Okay, so now where's the money going to come from? I'll give you better schools. Fine. How do we fund that? You're going to cut taxes and then build better schools? Who pays for it? You're going to tax the wealthy? Really? Well, then they're going to move out of the country or move to another state. We're taxed enough. I paid $70,000 last year in taxes. How much more would you like me to pay? Really? Enough already. It's out of control. I don't know why the hell I got on this tangent, but that's why I love my show, because it's my fucking show. Let's go. By the way, my name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training, Dog Training Q&A. Sorry.
Holly.
Yes.
Yeah, I made it. I was trimming dog nails. Hi, Holly. Good to see you.
I'm sorry. That was good, Holly. I don't know where the fuck that came from.
All right.
Come on.
Chevy. Thanks to you making progress with my DAGSD.
Dog aggressive German Shepherd.
She doesn't lunge aggressively anymore, but will whine and spin.
Ah.
I haven't been correcting it because it's better than aggression. Should I start?
Chevy. Damn right it's better than aggression, but you're going to be creating an OCD behavior. Stop that right away, Chevy. Come on. You live in New Zealand. Let's go.
What does that have to do with anything?
What?
Because you live in New Zealand.
You shouldn't put up with that stuff when you live in New Zealand.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, why?
Because OCD. It's New Zealand.
Okay.
Next.
Cecily. Fearful dog is whining on neighborhood walks with owner, not with me. Should I correct whining with e-collar while owner walks the dog?
Yes, but then empower the owner to do it. Next.
Kathleen.
Hey, Kathleen.
I have a German Shepherd puppy that keeps chasing my cats. I have two little foster children, and it's becoming a dangerous situation.
Damn right.
What should I do? The puppy also goes crazy in the crate when the cat walks by. Okay.
Kathleen, make a bonker. It's a towel. It's wrapped up tight. Mm-hmm. All it is a towel. That's all it is. These are number 64 elastics.
Are you sure about that?
Yes, I'm positive about it. I have a whole freaking package of number 64 elastics. Okay? Mm-hmm. Got it? You are to say the word no, not scream it. No. And then firmly throw this at the dog. Got it? It's called a punisher. It's a proper punisher. There's a proper way to punish a dog. It will stop. Next.
Okay.
The last thing you need is a full-grown German Shepherd running around the place. Sorry, everybody on Spotify, but a Malinois, two German Shepherds, three very high drive dogs, they're not tired. And if a cat walked in here, they would probably lift up their heads. I would probably tell them no, and then that would be over with. All right? And all of them are capable of chasing cats. Okay? They might even kill a cat if they caught it, but they're not allowed to chase the cat. Got it? So you can do it too. Next.
Carol, when feeding dogs in crate, do you use special crate bowls that hook on crate?
No, Carol, I don't. I just use regular stainless steel bowls. My dogs eat in 30 seconds. I feed raw. There's your food. Eat it. Boom. Walk in. Take their food bowls. Throw them in the sink. Next.
My dogs have ones with LED lights that flash.
They do? There's a beat?
Totally.
Do they?
No.
Flamenco music because they're chihuahuas?
No, they like hardcore punk.
Do they really?
Mm-hmm.
Really?
Yeah.
Like 80s punk?
Yeah.
Really? Mm-hmm. Nice. Is that why you have mohawks on them, little mm-hmm. chihuahuas?
Yep, nice. Exactly. And little safety pins in their ears. I'm just going to die. No.
Kaiser's nipples are pierced. Next.
Oh, I just hurt myself.
Good.
Okay, Corey. Hi, guys. Love the videos and all the tips. Anytime my Aussie gets a punishment, he pees himself. Is there any way to correct this?
Yeah. Shit. That sucks, huh? Well, are you using any anger at all? Are you using anger? How's your timing? Can you switch punishments? What are you doing now? A bonker, a remote collar? Is it the word no that's doing it? Maybe you can soften up your word. You can just be like no and then tap on the remote. Maybe lower your voice. You know, a lot of people will be like, well, then stop punishing your dog. It's like, yeah, ideally. I mean, which brings up a good topic. You know, are you often punishing your dog and your dog's not understanding what you want? So next.
Holly.
Yes.
Tips for teaching down to 6-pound Pomeranian. When applying pressure on leash, we run out of leash and dog raises butt up more. Thinking about trying luring next. Thoughts?
So yeah, what you do is you lure. What you do is you sit on the ground. You sit on the ground with your legs bent up. Got it? So your legs aren't flat on the ground. Your legs are bent up. All right? And the dog's on one side. And then you take food and you stick it underneath your leg. And the dog has to crawl underneath the bend in your knee. Got it? It's got to crawl underneath the bend in your knee. And then you slightly lower your leg, pushing a little bit on the dog's back. And it makes the dog then go onto its belly. As soon as it's on its belly, mark it with yes, feed, 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 or click and feed. We clicker train. So you click and feed. Okay, there you go. Next. Look, no punishment involved. Why? Because Holly asked me, how do I teach a dog to do a behavior? Next.
Keemed. While talking with a family member or friend while on a walk, my dog will lay down at their feet or sit in between their legs. Is this good or bad? I don't know what this means.
To me, is your dog aggressive, anxiety, fearful, nervous, pushy, snotty? If you have an easy, lucky dog, what do I care? And if the person doesn't mind, then I don't mind. Now, jumping is another thing. Laying down, what do I care? Next.
Lydia, do you allow your dogs to correct one another? Obviously not aggressively.
Depends what they're doing, and it usually is aggressively. Now, that doesn't mean they get aggressive with each other, but that's the whole point. The whole point is that they let each other know that it's not something's not acceptable. So let's see. I can't remember the last time that's happened except for Ronan. I remember when Tex first came home. Tex is a new dog. He's the Malinois. I've only had Tex for 2 weeks. He ran up to Ronan, and Ronan doesn't like, Ronan's an independent dog. Very rarely will you see him playing with a dog. So he likes to he's this just stoic animal that just likes to walk around. And he was like, Tex was like, hey, let's play. And Ronan's like, he's like, and Ronan's like, I don't play. So Ronan went, rawr, boom, like that, nailed him. And I'm like, I leave it alone because it won't go any farther. So my dogs don't fight. My dogs don't fight with each other. My dogs don't play with each other. Next.
Dave G. Yeah. I wish you would unblock me on Periscope.
I might have blocked you on Periscope for being a dick, or maybe it was an accident. I apologize for blocking you. I used to block probably 50 people a night, though. And so every once in a while I would block the wrong person, but I would usually go back and unblock. But you might have been rude to me. You might have been mean to me. You might have been disrespectful to me. You might have been mean to my wife, which, I'll hunt people down for that. I don't do that. But I'm barely on Periscope anymore. The only thing I'm doing on Periscope is swimming dogs, and I'm doing that on Instagram stories now. So watch me on Instagram stories. I'm barely using Periscope. So you're really not missing much, buddy. You're really not missing much. But thanks for being on YouTube Live. Thanks.
E. Gilberti.
Yep.
What size prong do you suggest for a 10-month GSD that weighs 55
pounds? Get the 3-millimeter. Next.
Catherine Cox.
Which, by the way, guys, you never need anything bigger than a 3-millimeter prong collar. They make them up to 4.75 maybe, or 4.25. 3-millimeter is the biggest prong collar you need. Next.
Catherine Cox. Any tips if a dog acts fearful with an E collar, wanting to try, but dog didn't respond well to invisible fence collar, he acts fearful?
Catherine, two separate things. Number one, the dog should be fearful of the invisible fence collar because you're trying to scare the shit out of the dog not to go out of the yard. So it's supposed to be fearful. Remote collar is different. It's about 100 times less powerful. It's manual. Okay, an invisible fence collar has one setting. I mean, some of them have three settings, but it's high. It's holy effing shit, that freaking hurts. It's supposed to. You're trying to contain a dog into a yard, and you've got wildlife on the other side, or other things on the other side. Remote collar is a totally different tool. It is a totally different tool. Next. So as far as tips, watch my videos. Watch my videos. Next.
Blue and black. Haha. Thanks about the sniffing.
You're welcome.
SJ Oates. It is Steph. I knew it was. Good to see you guys. Too funny and still lots of great info.
I'd like to throw in some info in there. Next. Every once in a while, I like to give a helpful hint or tip.
Little tip or trick.
Little tip or trick. Next.
Gwendolyn.
Hey.
Hi, Jeff. Recently adopted a 10-month-old Mal, and thanks to you, we're making a lot of progress in manners and training. Working on place next.
Gwendolyn, bust your butt, girl. Bust your butt. Got it? You got yourself a dog. I want that dog remote collar trained. I want that dog on place. I want that dog to know all of its commands. I want that dog to be able to have an on-off switch. I want you to be able to knock. We don't get rid of dogs' drive ever. I love my high-drive dogs. The dogs I've got right next to me are super high drive. They can go for hours and hours and hours in drive. But right now, they're in my office, three people here. I got kids around. It's like, guys, do nothing. And that's what they do. Okay? They do that. So I want your dog to have a default off switch. Next.
Doggy Detour.
Hey, Doggy Detour.
I have a small dog rescue and appreciate all the free content. You guys are great. Going to get a mini educator soon after listening to all your videos.
Oh, awesome. Cool.
Holly. Howdy, Joelle. Waiting for more dog training workout videos.
Oh, there you go, Holly. Joelle's going to be on in about 4 minutes. Next.
Michelle.
Hey, Michelle.
Hi, Jeff. Have you done video on starting a pack walk? I'm still in training mode with my three, but when can I try three together?
Now, because we really don't do pack. Well, I do. I'm going to do a pack walk tonight, I think. Are we walking tonight? Mm-hmm. Peter's up. Did Peter already go?
He's not coming.
What?
He has work to catch up on.
What?
Yeah.
He's got up until text him. Text him now and tell him he's got up until probably we won't get there to what? 9:15?
Yeah.
Get to 9:15 to catch up on work. And then tell me he can call his West Coast clients when we get back. Because it's a 3-hour time difference if he's at West Coast clients.
I tried.
It's just not the same.
You know what? Maybe you have to put the foot
down. I'm going to.
Yeah.
Next.
So,
as far as doing a pack walk, start with one, and then you'll do two on one side, one on the other side, and then swap sides. But tonight I'll have four dogs. I don't know. I mean, it'll be pitch black out, so it'll be hard for me to make a video, but one of these days, we're going to start at 7 o'clock. We probably should do it soon before it starts getting dark. Romy wants to go on one of the walks with us. And I told her, like, tonight's not a good night because we get back so late.
Yeah.
But I said, we're going to have to do one walk at, like, 7, be back by 9, and we'll bring Romy with us.
Okay.
And then, yeah, I'll do it when there's daylight. We have to do it soon, though, because pretty soon daylight's not going to be even at 7. I know.
Then she won't be able to hang.
I know. No. Next.
Plus, she's going to be so busy. Leanne?
Yep.
What's your opinion about flying with your dog commercially? I don't know how I feel about it after hearing horror stories on the news. If my dog knows how to be calm and has no anxiety, would it be fine? Thoughts?
This is the thing. You're okay. You're always going to hear about the dog that died in cargo. Got it? If a dog dies, it's 58 minutes. No, it's 8:27 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. If a dog dies right now, on an airplane, by 8:30, the world is going to know. But until then, tens of thousands of dogs are flying cargo. Everybody's got a horror story. Everybody. When I brought Kira in from Europe, she flew cargo. I've got clients actually fly them up on their private planes, but I mean, I've got clients that fly their dogs to us in cargo.
Small dog that was sent to me.
Yeah, in cargo, yeah.
Yeah,
so
she was fine.
So you're always going to hear horror stories. It, you know, is there a risk? Sure. I bet you more dogs probably die on the highway, though, in car accidents than in planes. Next. And more dogs absolutely die. I think 100,000 dogs a year die by being hit by cars every year. How many dogs die in cargo? 16, something like that. Next.
Tiffany, never introduce dogs on leash. Proper protocol?
Never introduce a dog on a leash. You want to do, watch my socialization videos. It's all done off leash, but it's only done with known dogs. I would never introduce my dog to an unknown dog. So being a dog trainer and specializes in dog socialization as well, we've got a certain protocol for that. So it's all done. Best way to do it is go on a structured walk and migrate, but that's a sleight of hand. That doesn't mean they're going to get along. There's a lot of factors. The humans in the room, the dogs, the animal behavior, what you know, are they aggressive? Are they not aggressive? Their energy levels, their skill set with you know, socializing other dogs. There's a lot of different variables. So that's a really long answer. Some of these are very long answers. So that's more of like a Skype session or a one-on-one. What I would do is in a neutral area, you want to make sure that usually people over-talk and they over-praise. It should be a pretty silent interaction. We show how we do it in, let's do something this week, Joelle. All right, how to introduce dogs. Okay, let's do something this week. We'll do a video this week. All right, next.
Mama Bear.
Hey, Mama Bear.
Any advice for a 17-month intact male Rottweiler who is getting growled at a lot? Is it hormones he's giving off?
You know, you're around a lot of asshole dogs. You know what I mean? I mean, bottom line. So, you know, the thing is this, you shouldn't have to decept your dogs because of other dogs' behavioral problems. So, you know, and I'm just like a woman's right to choose. I'm all for an owner's right to choose as far as whether you spay or neuter your dog. So I've gotten all my dogs to me already fixed, except for Kira, and Kira is still intact. My next dog, I mean, I just got Tex. He's only 2 years old, so he's probably going to be my next dog for a while. My next dog was going to be male. It was going to be a German Shepherd, and I was going to keep him intact. And if other dogs have a problem with that, tough shit. Get over it. It's not my problem. So your dog can be a target for other people's dogs. But again, you just have to be on defense a little bit more, you know, around other dogs. Next.
Jorge says, you can always look on olx.co.cr for land on sale. You guys are always welcome here.
Oh, awesome. Will do. Thank you. Jorge, email me your information, buddy. I'd love to talk to you. I've actually thought about getting property in Costa Rica. Actually, I thought about it a while ago. Next.
Marianne says, I'm thinking to host an RV seminar in New Jersey in the future. Where can I send an email about how to find out about it to find out what it takes on my side?
You can just email me directly, Jeff, J-E-F-F, at solidcaninetraining.com. Or just go to my website, solidcaninetraining.com, hit the contact form, fill out a little form and just tell me. So it goes to me. I answer all my own emails.
Okay, I'm punching out now.
Oh, you are?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, great.
Bye-bye.
Great. Hey, Sabrina. So Sabrina's got a super chat question, fear of mailbox, how to end the daily scare session. So what I would do is this. So walking by the mailbox, going out to the mailbox, is it a mail slot? What's going on? What I would do is I would teach your dog how to do a downstay next to the mailbox and F with the mailbox. And then also when your dog isn't showing fear, click and reward. Take a bunch of food, scatter it around the bottom of the mailbox, have your dog eat around the bottom of the mailbox. Next.
Josu, yes, she's crated.
Josh.
Right here?
That's Josh.
Okay.
Yeah. That's Josh.
Yes, she's crated at night and 4 hours during the day. Heals great and does a good play. She just loves jumping fences. Thank you.
So that's going to be on that. Buddy, you got your work cut out for you. You might need a more powerful remote. We actually have a double Tritronics 550, which is probably six times more powerful than the remotes we normally use. And we use those for dogs for certain things we want to stop. So that might be what you would need to do. Next.
Heather S., I have a young 7-month-old bulldog client who refuses to walk. She just sprawls out on the ground and won't budge. I've tried food, excited voices, leash pressure with prong. Thoughts on motivating her?
Okay, so what I want you to do is this. Don't do food because the dog's not going to do food if it's fear. You can't. If the dog eats the food, that means it's not fearful and the dog's just full of shit. All right, excited voices, that doesn't work as much as we think it does. Leash pressure with prong, thoughts on motivating her. This is what I want to do. First of all, it's a 7-month-old bulldog. Make sure it's healthy. Bottom line is this. I got a great experiment for you. Ready? Take it into a fenced-in area. Take it for a walk in the fenced-in area. Got it? Then I want you to do is this. When it sprawls out, unhook the clip. Walk away from the dog. See what it does. I guarantee you the dog's going to get up and run around. What does that tell you? The dog's full of shit. You got it? The dog's full of shit. The dog's playing you. Everybody's like, no, the dog's afraid. No, it's not. The dog's not afraid. Unclip the leash, and what does the dog do? If that dog is afraid, what will it do? It'll still stay sprawled out, or it'll run away. But in order to run away, guess what you got to do? You got to move. So you might as well freaking walk with me. What I want you to do is this, east, west, north, south. east, west, north, south. So pretend you're heading north and your dog sprawls out. What I want you to do is stop, go south, leash pressure. That doesn't work, head east, leash pressure. That doesn't work, head west, leash pressure. That doesn't work, go back to north, go tough shit, dog, let's go. Don't drag the dog. You're going to be, you know, you don't want to drag the dog on the pavements. If you had a remote collar on that dog, oh, we'd get that dog to move. What would we do? Yeah, I'll give you a high correction for doing a belly flop on the cement. Why? Because it's a choice the dog is making. People are struggling, like, no, use more motivation. What should we do? Put a piece of kibble every 2.76 centimeters around the fucking block? It's probably overweight as it already is. It's a damn bulldog. No. It was like, it's called a walk. Let's go. The dog is just being a snot, most likely. Next.
This is a continuation. Oh. Said, I know bulldogs don't have great stamina, but this happens after 1 minute of being
outside. Right, exactly. Trust me. I've met them all, guys. I've met them all. Next.
Jody, thanks so much, guys. I love the help you share with everyone. We'll divide and conquer with the dachshunds.
Ta-da!
Yes.
Jody, damn right you will. I want you to wear an armored chest plate. I want you to have a sword. Okay? Let's go. What's her name? Zena? The warrior princess?
I don't know.
Get all Zena on me. I want to see photos. Next.
Jane T. Hi, Jeff and Linda. How would you suggest I handle a surprise run-in with another dog? For example, a blind corner where another dog appears at the same time as we do.
That's always going to happen. Well, if it's on leash, that means it's hopefully connected to a handler. You know, you got to get out of the way. If it's off leash, you kick it. So Whitney was charged by 2 off-leash dogs tonight.
Oh, boy.
Yeah. Our new intern who's coming in October 1st, she's in South Carolina. She was charged by 2 off-leash dogs. She threw her skateboard at it, ran away. I'm like, damn right. You freaking do other things too. Do what you love to do. So that's always going to happen. You just got to move out of the way really quick or just keep going forward really quick. Next.
Lydia.
Hey, Lydia.
Should a dog not be allowed to lay on a place area if it is not commanded in place? Dog lays on dog bed because he wants to, but he can break it since I didn't tell him to. Will that confuse
him? No. My dog's. No, you didn't. No, I'm not running a boot camp in my place. It's like, no, my dogs can lay down wherever the hell they want to. But I mean, when we come into my office, though, they automatically lay down next to me here because it's a small office. When we go to my office at work, they'll either go in their crates or they'll go lie down in their place beds. But if the dog's in your living room and it lays down on a place cot, let it. Next.
Sean, my lab puppy wouldn't leave our 6-year-old SBT alone.
Uh-huh.
Kept biting his ears. 3 months, we've tried positive only here in England. It didn't work. Half hour and 4 attempts with a bonker, problem solved. Thanks.
Did you hear that, UK? Did you hear that? Am I going to talk louder?
I think everyone has heard you.
All right. Sorry. And I'm not against positive. I'm not against, guys, please. Joe, how many times did you reward a dog today? You worked, what, an 8-hour shift?
Mm-hmm.
How many times did you say yes to a dog?
Probably 1,000.
Okay. Just you.
Yeah.
And there was 2 trainers working today.
Yep.
Right?
I put a video up of us with Wade. We're like, yes.
Yes.
Like,
yes. And when there's 3 trainers, that's 3 times 1,000.
Yeah.
How many times did you say no today to a dog?
I don't know.
Probably a couple dozen.
Yeah, a couple dozen.
Yeah. Because we work with dog aggressive dogs, human aggressive dogs, fearful dogs, nervous dogs, really badly behaved dogs. But most of our day is saying yes to a dog and rewarding it, but not to get it to stop something. It's impossible. It's a scam. You're being lied to. By the way, I'm not angry. Someone's like, who's this angry guy? I'm just passionate about this shit. And I'm sick and tired. I'm so sick and tired of all the lies and all these people trying to make everything feel good. And no, dog training, build a bond with your dog. Your dog just bit my fucking kid. Like, the only thing I'm building is a damn cedar box for the damn dog. Sorry, but biting dogs get killed. Wake up, everybody. We're not talking about, like, you know, fluff here. We're talking about the lives of dogs, and they're being killed on a daily basis for simple stuff. Spend time at a shelter. These dogs that are coming in, I can walk. This is not an ego statement. I can walk into any shelter in the United States and grab 90% of those dogs and have them trained in a week. Not fully off-leash trained, have them trained in a week. It's not that hard to do. But meanwhile, people are struggling for years with their damn dogs. Any decent dog trainer can do that. Not just me. Any decent dog trainer can do that. It's disgusting what's happening in our industry. And now with countries banning tools and with all these people jumping on this, like, you know, hate stuff, it's getting out of control. Don't worry about me. I can retire tomorrow. I'm all set. But, like, dogs are going to die. Next.
Kim Francis. Go, Jeff. Go.
Yeah. I'm a freaking rampage.
Yeah.
Damn, Amanda's going to pull some memes out of this one.
Oh, I'm sure.
Jeez. Amanda, cut up this show, man. We got gold for the next year.
Sean Allen, here in the UK, people are becoming such snowflakes. Drives me insane.
But they're not just snowflakes in the UK. I'm not bashing a whole damn country. I get more hate. I get death threats from the UK, guys. I get death threats. And I'm being serious. I get tons of anti-Semitic emails and death. People literally are threatening to kill me if I come into that country. When I went over there to do a seminar, we had to file police reports. We had to hire security companies. People literally were telling me they were going to kill me right online. I mean, I'm a dog trainer. I'm doing a seminar for 40 people. It's incredible the amount of hate that we get out of the UK. Incredible how much hate is out there. Next.
Kim Francis, y'all are so bad having piercings.
Thanks, Kim.
And Nervous, I'm seeing a lot of Instagram moments here.
Yes. Thanks, Sabrina.
Rhonda, can't believe I'm actually on live feed. Finally, I listen to the podcast daily.
Rhonda, I love you. Thank you for supporting me. Thank you for being a fan. Thank you for listening. You know, I truly appreciate it. Next.
Heather S., I'm loving those new video clips you do on Instagram from these live Q&As. I just shared the vet one on all my social media platforms, and I'm getting great feedback. Thank you.
Thank you, Heather, for sharing. I saw your comment. Heather, you never have to ask me permission to share my shit. Guys, you can and you know what? If there's it, I get a lot of people that watch my stuff that hate my guts. Hey, guys, how are you? I just want you to know, if you're watching this show and you can't stand me, I want you to know that I actually care about you. I care about you. I care about you. I care about you. I want you to truly know that. I really do. I understand what your passion is. And believe it or not, I don't want dogs to be hurt either. You know what I mean? I want dogs to stay alive. But I have empathy for you. I really, really do. But it's so funny because people love to take my videos and they love to put them on these websites, on these chat rooms, on Facebook, and they use my videos to be like, look at this asshole, Gellman. Look what he's doing. Fuck him. He shouldn't be training dogs. I want people to know. I want you to continue doing that. And please make sure there's a link to my social media. Please, please, please make sure there's a link to my social media when you're bashing me. Okay? You've got to understand how much I monetize that shit. You've got to understand. I had the last seminar I did, the last T3 in September. It's $4,000 for the week per student. Three students were there. They all found me literally on a Facebook forum bashing me. They didn't know who I was. They had no idea who I was. They discovered me from someone sharing a video, slandering me, bashing me, and they saw the video and they were like, huh, this guy looks pretty interesting. They went to my website, they went to my social media, and they went to my week-long seminar, $12,000. One of the people that was at my last seminar, we're talking about banning, she's like, I have a confession. She's like, Jeff, can you please unblock me from your Facebook page?
Classic.
I blocked her 2 years ago because she was one of those people that wrote me mean stuff. Meanwhile, she was at my seminar to learn the information that I had because all the stuff that she thought was the right stuff wasn't working. That took a lot of courage for her to admit that. So Libby, I love you. Next.
Dita Misfits. Hi from Australia. I've adopted a Siberian Husky who gets very fixated with other dogs when on walks and will lunge to attack. Mm. Tried reward, but it doesn't work. Any suggestions?
So Dita, the only thing a reward would do is make it worse. Got it? What you were taught was to redirect. You were taught was to take a high value reward, and when the dog is fixated, you are taught to take the high-value reward and to try to redirect the dog, correct? I mean, like, I mean, that's what they teach. You were taught how to make your dog aggressive. You can't use a reward in that situation. You actually are rewarding aggression. You're rewarding reactivity. You're rewarding lunging. You are increasing. Rewards increase the chances of it happening again. A reward teaches a dog to repeat a behavior. The dog was thinking about lunging. Food showed up. That's the incentive, and it does it more. This is what's being taught out there. We use rewards every day in our training. So what you need to do is you need to learn how to properly punish a dog. Then when the dog walks by calmly without thinking about lunging, then you reward. They have it backwards. You were trained backwards. You and millions of other people around the world are being trained backwards. So what you do is you need to learn. Get a prong collar, get a remote collar. When your dog starts looking, thinking naughty thoughts, what do? Correct. Correct. You'll be told, though, that will make it worse. And my comment always is, prove it. They can't prove it because they don't do it. And nobody has done a study on it. We do it thousands and thousands of times successfully. That's how we rehab dogs. Then once we stop the unwanted behavior, then we reward the good stuff. Punish first, teach what you want, and then reward. That's the sequence. That's how you change behaviors. Next.
Rhonda, rescued Pit 1 year ago and have 3 chihuahuas now. One of the chihuahuas will not come out. If the pit is out, he'll hide under the couch. Problem?
You've got either a fearful dog or your pity is, you know, he's getting picking up a vibe. So anytime, it's not because it's a pity. Anytime you like, I've got 2 chihuahuas and then I've got a lot of large breed dogs. I wouldn't let them run around together because of the weight difference, not because of the breed, not because of the breed difference. So I used to have 1 Chihuahua and 2 German Shepherds a while ago. Excuse me. All these dogs are dead now. They were best friends and they played. But they grew up together and they knew how to be, like, soft with each other. You know what I mean? The German Shepherds knew how to play appropriately with a Chihuahua. So what you would do is I would get that dog to stop going underneath the couch. I would have the dog go to place. Or even if that dog is that afraid, I have no problem with you being like, hey, you know what? You're not comfortable. Why don't you go in your crate right now? That's not training, but that might be just smart management right now. Next.
Lydia. Hi, Joelle. Obsidian's mom here. So happy for you.
Oh, look at that.
Okay, Lydia. Thanks.
Look at that. Nice.
E. Gilberti. You have a lot of place videos. Do you recommend one that is best?
No. Just any of them. Any of them. Just really. Just teach it. Next.
Michelle, thank you. I'll watch for the pack walk video. Have to tell you, your videos have made my relationship with my dog so much more fun and engaging for all of us. Love you.
Oh, Michelle, thank you so much for the kind words. Thank you.
Kathleen.
Hey, Kathleen.
Jeff, I had the question above about the German Shepherd puppy chasing cats. The pup is almost 5 months old. Still use bonker or would e-collar be more effective?
Either one. Either one. The cool thing about a bonker is it's $1.99. So, and where remote collar is $199. If you got a remote collar, use the remote collar. Absolutely. Next. The remote collar will be easier to use because the dog's probably moving fast and you don't need to have good aim. Next.
Chevy, awesome. Thanks. Sometimes she doesn't even whine or spin. She anxiously breathes really heavily but holds it together.
Yeah.
Pretty proud of her. When is the right time to introduce food?
So what I would do is, Chevy, correct the whining. Introduce food when the dog stops the whining. Because the dog might not take food while it's whining. And then you have to mark it. Make sure you mark it with yes and then food. Click and then food. Got it? Make sure your timing is right. So no and then punishment, yes and then reward. So you know if the first sign your dog does something wrong, follow it with a punisher. You do yes if the sign your dog does something right, and then you follow it with a reward. Next.
Russ says, hey, Joel. Hey, Russ.
Hey, Russ.
Vicent.
Yes.
Let's see. Hi, guys. Love the show. How can I introduce two dogs that got into a two-second fight? It was mainly growling. I just adopted a GSD. It sneaked inside the house, and my dog didn't like that.
It sneaked inside the house? How did it sneak inside the house if it's your dog? Okay, so if they got into a little squabble, it was 2 seconds, so one, two, it's, you know, knock it off. What I would do is socialize them together and do things with them together. Make sure you've got lots of structure, down them next to each other, walk them together, and if you see any nonsense, you correct. Next.
Do you want me swearing on your show when people say AF?
No.
Okay. Heather.
We don't swear on the show. All right.
Bulldog isn't fearful. She's just lazy AF.
Okay. If you've got a fucking lazy bulldog.
She said I could probably drag her for 5 minutes before she would attempt to get up.
Okay. So what I would do is, this. You've got to get that dog to freaking move. Remote collar. Remote collar overrides laziness. Next.
Chevy, Zena is a New Zealander, by the way, and she's hot AF. AJ, when dog goes on place caught by himself, he always looks for a release command to get off. Should I just give him a command even though I didn't put him there?
You missed the other one from Chevy.
Yeah, I didn't see it.
He asked you a question. Oh. He asked you a question. People are trying to interact with you. You're blowing the guy off.
I'm sorry, Chevy.
Chevy's from New Zealand. He might invite you out there.
I know.
Right.
Joel, do you laugh all day with this guy around? Cracks me up.
That's
up for debate.
I'm actually not like this at work.
No, he's not.
I'm very professional at work. Guys, this is my, like, at work, I'm not swearing at work. I'm very professional. I'm not loud like this. I don't make sexual connotations at all. I'm not like this, you know, X-rated person. It's a very professional. We run a very serious operation. We have very serious dogs. I've got a staff of 11. I am the boss, and I'm leading them. So in order for me to be a proper leader, I set by example, and this show is something totally, totally different. And if you're brand new to your world, and you're saying, holy shit, I would never send my dog to this guy. I said, that's okay, you know, but look at my body of work. You know, look at our body of work. Look at the work we do, especially my staff. They're the ones that are doing all the hard work. All right, so my trainers and my kennel staff, my front desk staff, they're the ones that are doing, you know, all the hard work. So. But no, at work, I'm not like this at all. Next.
All right. So it was the place one. I don't think you answered it. So AJ says, when dog goes on place caught by himself, he always looks for a release command to get off. Should I just give him a command?
Yeah, AJ, go ahead. It ain't going to hurt. Next.
Heather S. Joel, you seem so much more confident these days. Props to you on getting more comfortable in front of the camera. Thanks to this guy.
Look at that. Yeah. Remember that?
Yeah.
Fucking put you in the hot seat.
Literally forcing me to get on camera. It's cool.
Yeah.
I appreciate it.
Yeah. Yeah. Why is that like that? What the fuck is that?
What are you doing?
I don't know, but why is your screen frozen? Is anybody else's screen frozen? Or just Lynn's computer?
Okay. Mama Bear.
Yeah.
Totally agree with you as to the UK. I'm the lady who asked the question about the intact Rottweiler. No way I'm risking my dog's life by not training him right. He's not a handbag dog.
Nice. Good.
Nice. Sean Allen. My friend had a bulldog. Mate said it can't walk properly. Moved quick enough when it smelled my hamburger.
That's right. It's true.
I can't. George, mailed you the info direct to your email. Check the spam box just in case.
All right.
Cheers.
We'll do, Jorge. Thank you, man. Love you.
Seven Rabbitry. Hi, I appreciate all you do. I received the mini educator today, but dog freeze in sitting position and scratch the e-collar area strong. Does she will get over it soon? Working level six.
Okay, so Seven, but you're brand new to my world. I've never seen a question from you before. Thank you. Welcome to my show. And if you're not new, I apologize. I usually remember everybody. We've got, I don't know, 60,000 people that belong to this channel. What I want you to do is this leash. Remember, the remote collar is not magic. Use the leash, guide it. The remote collar is not directional. Guide the dog. You still got to train the dog. Guide the dog. Next.
Yolanda. Hi, guys. Love your show and videos. 8-week-old boxer puppy that whines, cries in his crate. Any suggestions? I'm trying the pet corrector and bonker.
Yeah. You can also open up the crate door, take a little bit of finger, and give him a poke. Remember, he's 8 weeks old. I give dogs, when I have an 8-week-old puppy, there's a little bit of free pass going there. A little bit of free pass going there, right? So, you can go over to the crate, but you can correct it. You can say no, tap on the crate. You can do that, but you're going to get a little bit of whining for some people get whining for years, but for the first week, I'm a little bit tolerant. Next.
Rhonda, taking fearful, insecure, adopted pup, growling and charging people daily with prong and e-collar. However, sometimes he'll whine under breath and move away. Still correct?
So the fact that he's moving away, if he's moving away from the environmental that he used to go after, that's a good sign. That means your dog is going like, okay, I'll do that. At the beginning of the sequence of the rehab process, I allow dogs to move away from things they're uncomfortable from because that's them telling me, hey, listen, man, I get it, right? I get it. I'm moving away from that. I'm uncomfortable. I'd rather have a dog use that as a coping mechanism than lashing out. Next.
Sandy, how do you stop 4-month-old puppy from eating acorns in the yard?
A 4-month-old puppy is a 16-week-old puppy. It shouldn't be in the backyard unsupervised. So you want to keep that dog on a leash. You've got to keep that dog on a leash. It's 16 weeks old. I mean, that's what you want to do. I would never let my 4-month-old dog off leash, without I can't correct it. So I'd have it on a leash. If it reached out to get an acorn, you can say no, and you can give it the leash. You give the leash a pop. Next.
Tiffany, excited to see you guys do a video on introducing dogs. I do this off leash, no words spoken, maybe sometimes the word no.
Awesome.
But I always know the background of both dogs. I use a dressage whip at times.
Tiffany, that's exactly how we're going to do it. I bet you we do it very, very similar. Next.
Rhonda, when are you coming to Phoenix?
I'm not coming to Phoenix till 2019. Next.
Kathleen, I want to thank you for your input. I've been watching your videos. They've been most helpful.
Awesome, Kathleen. Thank you so much.
Milligan Valley, when you have fearful, nervous dogs in on board and train that won't take food to counter condition due to nervousness, do you just pet to reward for compliance?
Sometimes just a verbal. Good. Sometimes if they're so nervous and you do physical touch, that makes them even more nervous. If you can do a pet and that will get if that doesn't hurt, believe it or not, guys, praise can hurt. Everyone's like, oh no, praise is good. Not if it makes things worse, it doesn't. So we've had dogs that have gotten worse because of praise. So what you can do is don't feed the dog out of a bowl, only feed through training. Eventually the dog's food drive will overtake its fear drive. Next.
Jeff, typical situation, for how long and at what point in the training process do you dump the clicker and food?
Oh, once they understand the command. Once they understand the command, like owners don't get clickers. Every once in a while, an owner might have to use food as a reinforcer, but we know the behavior doesn't have to be marked anymore because we use the word yes. Well, we switch the clicker out for the word yes, or some dogs we just do yes. Some dogs we don't. Some dogs we're not on a clicker. And why we start one dog and not another dog? No reason. No rhyme. No reason. Next.
Tiffany, thanks for all you do. Madly in love.
Oh my gosh, Tiffany, love you too, honey. Thank you.
Cassandra, dog will hold place, no problem, but barks at anyone new entering the home while on place. I correct with e-collar and bonker. He will not stop. Any tips?
E-collar, how high? We have to. We're done. We're done with the show. But how high are you going on that e-collar? How high are you going? You know, high. He won't stop. Bonker. 70. It's pretty high. You can try going higher. Make sure that e-collar is on. Make sure that e-collar is on nice and snug. You will bark, yelp, bark, yelp. Yeah. So what I would do is, how about a good old-fashioned leash pop? A good old-fashioned leash pop or a barker? A barker. Or do you got to do more duration work? Work on more duration work and then work on doorbell training and knocking training and just role play it, role play it, role play it, role play it. But you have got to figure out a punisher that's going to work. So a very firm bonker. You can even bonk. This is what I would do. I would get the dog to break command and not bark. Meaning, what will that dog do to break? So you put the dog on a tie back. Dog's in place on a tie back. Dog knows place. We're winding the show down, guys. After this question, you know, we're done with the show. So thank you so much. What you do is put the dog on a tie back, and then the dog's in place, and have the dog break place, do something, knock on the door, ring the doorbell, something that normally would get the dog to get up and leave, get down on the ground, go like this, hey puppy, the dog breaks, no, correct. Get that dog to jump back onto that placemat, get that dog to be into a down. Also, is the dog in a down when it's barking? Dog will hold place, no problem with barks. Is the dog in a down or is it sitting? If it's sitting, the dog should be in a down. Put it in a down. Now, I'm not using obedience to fix a behavioral problem because I keep telling people not to do that, but we've got to figure out, we got to get some leverage here. Let's figure out what
she said. No, he will sit.
Okay, boom. Get him in the down. Get him in the down. All right, try that. But you've got to correct for, you've got to get that dog to break place for something else where it normally doesn't bark, but it breaks place, correct it for that. You need leverage. You need leverage on this dog. Then that dog will be in place and go, oh shit, I better watch my P's and Q's. All right, guys, this is the show. Well, this is actually Chapstick, but this has been the show. My name is Jeff Gellman. Linda started off. She's Wicked Big Lashes. You can go to lindagellman.com. Go to lindagellman.com. Go to her Facebook page. When she goes on to her show, which is probably starting right now, you can go to my Jeff Gellman Facebook page, and I put her show on there. Support my wife. She does unique makeup. She has got great makeup tips. Support my wife. Buy some shit. It's hard for me to sugar daddy her any longer. She's been asking for handouts. You know, I got all kinds of other people asking for handouts. So you don't ask for handouts. Joelle's very self-supporting.
I try.
You're very self-supporting. Very independent. You don't even like help sometimes.
No, I don't.
I know. It's a pride thing.
Yeah.
Like, I can do it myself.
Yep. Exactly.
I can do it myself.
Yeah.
All right. All right, guys. Madly in love with all of you. Thank you so much. Jeff Gellman, Solid Canine Training. You can go to rvdogtrainer.com. I've got a seminar in Providence in 2 weeks. After that, I'm going to be in Elkhart, Indiana. After that, I'm going to be in Frederick, Maryland, then down to Greenville, South Carolina. So we're really, 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 really excited. All right. Take care, everybody. Madly in love.